This video series is intended to provide an overview of Passive House principles and to show how they are being implemented at the 68-unit Hanick Corona Senior Residence in New York City.
Provide an overview of the principles and how we're actually complying with the standard. So the first one is high R-value continuous insulation. So the idea is you want to really wrap the building in a high level of insulation and wrap it completely around so it's continuous from the bottom underneath the slab all the way up the sides and over the roof. So the idea is we're going to now make sure that we have good thermal performance in this building. So for our area, we're looking at R-values of about 38 to 40. That's what we're needed in sort of this project to achieve the Passive House standard and to achieve the, you know, the actual energy results we're looking for. So the benefits of high R-value insulation is that we're going to reduce the heat gain in the summertime. We're also going to reduce the heat loss in the wintertime, and we're going to maintain that comfortable indoor environment that we're looking for with the standard. We really need to make sure that we have a continuous air tightness layer aligned with that thermal layer. So the idea is that they work together in order to for us to achieve the thermal performance in the building. So that air tightness layer is going to prevent conditioned air from escaping the building. It's also going to prevent unconditioned air from the outside entering into the building. So we're really maintaining a high level of air tightness. And this is going to reduce drafts. It's going to reduce the possibility of moisture damage. But it's also going to help with the thermal properties of the building. We're going to reduce the heat gain in the summertime, and we're going to reduce the heat loss in the wintertime by having that air tightness. What we're shooting for with the Passive House standard is 0.6 air changes per hour at 50 pascals. So as you pressurize or depressurize the building, that's the amount of air that's allowed to leak through the enclosure. So it's a very, very high level of air tightness. Since we have a very favorable interior volume to exterior surface area, we're actually going to be shooting for the 0.033 CFM per square foot of enclosure at 50 pascals in order for us to really make sure that we have that sufficient air barrier that we're looking for with this project. So again, it's going to start underneath the building. So whether we're building a basement or if it's a slab on grade construction like this project, we have to make sure that we have that insulation underneath the structural elements of the building. So it starts underneath with, in this case for our project, we're doing 6 inches of 100 PSI extruded polystyrene insulation. So this insulation has the ability to have a high compressive strength. So as we pour the slab on top of it, we're going to maintain structural stability with this building. So we have it 6 inches. It's actually done in 3 layers of two inch insulation apiece. We staggered the boards and actually taped the seams. This way we have full continuity of that insulation. The insulation then is going to wrap above the slab, so it's going to come up around the slab edge and it's going to fully engulf the slab itself. So this way we're going to maintain the thermal properties from the slab edge to the soil that surrounds it. So that's going to wrap up. In certain areas of the building, we were able to achieve the full 6 inches. In other areas where we had lot lines or we had existing conditions, we were able to maintain a minimum of 3 inches. So we're going to have that insulation come up and it's going to maintain that thermal performance. As that insulation comes up, it's going to meet the exterior wall assembly. So the exterior wall assembly is going to come down and it's going to sit on top of that insulation layer. So now we have that continuity between the sub-slab insulation coming up the side of the slab and then meeting the wall assembly as it comes down. So we're maintaining that continuity. Our air barrier in this case is going to be the slab itself. So the slab itself is about 3 feet thick. So we have a lot of concrete there. So that concrete is going to be fairly dense, and it's going to provide us the level of air tightness we're looking for. As that concrete comes up, we're going to attach our window assembly and our building assembly to that concrete, and we're going to show you how we made that connection with some high-performance tapes. The exterior wall itself is it's actually 2 different wall set types. So we have a front facade, which is using 1 wall type, and then the 2 side and back facades have a different wall type. And we'll get into the difference and how we're implementing the products. So in the front of the building, it's a panelized construction. So we have steel studs, and then we actually have dense glass, and then we have exterior insulation, and then the metal panels. But for us, we wanted to make sure that this whole project, the whole mantra of this project has been sort of keep it simple. And the idea is that we wanted to make sure that we had a simple product that we can use and that it was going to maintain good continuity and we were going to have success in implementing it in the field. So we use a product from a company called Soprima. They make this product called SoperSeal Express G. And what it is, it's actually a peel and stick membrane already adhered from the factory of dense glass. So the idea is that whole 4x8 sheet of dense glass has the air barrier already installed from the factory. So the factory installed, it's done correctly, it's in a controlled environment, so we have a very high level of confidence that it's going to work well. In the field, it's actually screwed into the steel studs that use fine thread screws. And as you use those fine thread screws, it actually heats up the membrane itself, and then it self-seals those screw holes. So now we're getting a self-sealing aspect using that screw. And then all we have to do is detail the seams. So it's primer on the seams, and then you go ahead and use the peel and stick like you normally would any type of building, and you seal the seams, and you provide that a continuity. And then you have to deal with all the penetrations. So as any penetrations go through the building, let's like in this photo here, we have a ERV penetration that's grabbing fresh air from the outside. So that now is air sealed to the peel and stick membrane via a tape from Sega Fentrum tape. So that Fentrum tape is applied. It's clean, dry surface. You're going to apply it to the Comfo pipe as well as the actual Suprema board, and we're going to maintain that air barrier continuity from the Suprema to the Comfo pipe as it exits through the building. Same thing with the windows. The windows, we're going to follow the same process. We're using the Sega Fentrum tape, and we're sealing the windows themselves to the peel and stick to the Suprema product. So again, maintaining that air barrier continuity through any of the penetrations that go through the building. We have an interior drywall surface here. We have a 6-inch mineral wool bat insulation. So between the studs, we have 6-inch mineral wool insulation from Roxel. Then we have our Suprema board that's providing our air tightness layer. And then outboard of that, we have 4 inches of mineral wool insulation. It's a high density mineral wool insulation. And then that is actually going to be adhered to the building using screws, stainless steel screws that are going through. The design did change a little bit, so we're not using this thermally broken clip. We actually have an insulation that's self-supporting, the 4-inch mineral wool, and has a high enough density that we can actually screw through it, and it can support itself and support the weight of the panels as they're attached. So this clip is now eliminated, and then that's also just increased the performance of our wall because we don't have these clips at certain intervals on center. And then outboard of that, we have a hatch channel, and then we have the actual steel panels or the panelized system attaching to that hatch channel. So it's a very simple build-up in terms of the wall assembly, but it's high performance and it's performing very, very well. On the other three sides, as I mentioned, we did a little bit of a different wall build-up. So we actually have a EFIS system. So our air barrier in this case is going to be a fluid-applied air barrier. So we're using a Parex Weather Seal product. So that's spray-applied and then it's back-rolled. And the idea is you want to make sure, as we're out there doing our quality control, we want to make sure that we're achieving the required thickness. So that Weather Seal needs to be installed in 10 to 12 wet mills. So you see this little wet mill film thickness gauge. So we're out there doing our quality control, making sure we're getting that 10 to 12 wet mills that we're looking for in order for us to have enough thickness of that product on the dense glass in order for us to, for it to act as a good air barrier. Still using the same Sega Fentrum tape to deal with the penetration. So we're using the Fentrum again to the windows. What's nice about the Fentrum, it has a fleece backing to it. So what we can actually do is we can sort of impregnate the Fentrum tape into the air barrier by rolling over it. So what we'll do is we'll apply the first layer of the weather seal and then tape the window to that first layer of weather seal and then go ahead and apply the second layer of weather seal over the tape. And you can see it done here at the head, sort of the head jam here. You can see that it's been applied and that's actually embedding this into the air barrier. So it's acting as one product. And then outboard of that, we're going to have our traditional 5-inch EFIS insulation. So it's pretty much same buildup as before. Interior drywall, 6-inch mineral wool bat insulation, dense glass with the Parex weather seal. And then outside of that, we have our EFIS. So it's a 5-inch insulation layer that's going to have a render on the outside, and we're going to have a traditional EFIS system on this end. So again, the same performance, R40 wall, so we're shooting for the same level of performance all the way around. We've done some quality control testing along the way. As we mentioned with the training, we're actually teaching folks how to do their own quality control, and we're providing quality control as a third party. So we've done a few tests on site, and actually both systems are performing very, very well. So we did a compartmentalization test of one unit, and actually found some leaks through some of the joints. We were able to seal those up. We actually hit a really good number. We actually were shooting for 0.3 CFM per square foot of enclosure, and we actually hit 0.12 on that model apartment. So a very, very tight apartment. So it's going to increase, we're going to decrease the amount of air leaving through that apartment to the outside. So we're going to maintain our high level of thermal comfort, but it's also great for indoor air quality because we're going to stop any pollutant transfer between units. So we're shooting for a very, very high level of compartmentalization. We recently completed a actual guarded blower door test on one of the floors. So what we ended up doing is pressurized the second floor, the third and the fourth floor, and then we tested the actual floor in the middle. So the third floor is actually, we had some quantitative results from that analysis. We're finding that, again, that floor is performing very, very well. So the simplicity of our design and the execution has been such a high level that we're actually getting 0.6 ACH at 50 pascals on that floor. So it's very, very well constructed building enclosure. So that actually, that wall assembly that we spoke about before actually extends all the way to the top of the building. So again, simplify the design, and what we ended up doing on the eighth floor, the actual roof deck actually sits, steps back a little bit, and what we're allowed to do is have that wall from the seventh floor go up past the eighth and become the parapet. So now it's one continuous wall that's going straight up, and that becomes our parapet around the building. So same buildup as the wall assembly. So again, we have our 6-inch mineral wool bat insulation in between the studs. We're either using our Parex system, our EFIS system, as our air tightness and insulation layer, or we're using our Suprema board and exterior mineral wool as the insulation layer. But again, that just extends right up the facade of the building and then becomes that parapet. So the same R40, wall assembly that we had on the walls, it becomes our parapet, and we're minimizing the amount of thermal bridging that's going out through that wall assembly. On the roof, we're trying to maintain the same level of performance as the walls, and have a high level of insulation there. So what we're using on the roof itself is going to be 8 inches of 100 PSI extruded polystyrene insulation. So again, we have a high compressive strength for any of the structural elements that are going to be sitting on top of this insulation, but we're getting the high R values that we're looking for in order to maintain that thermal comfort. The air tightness layer is going to come up the building, whether it's the Parex weather seal or it's the Suprema board. It's going to turn around the cap of the parapet, come back down, same product on the backside, and then it's going to adhere to the actual roof membrane underneath. So that's going to maintain our air tightness up through the parapet, down, and then onto the roof itself. So we're going to have that continuity of that air barrier as it goes through the parapet and onto the roof assembly.